For many people, God today is money, power, control. Now tell me, how could you build a long-term plan on something that is not long-term, that dissipates? Imagine someone saying, you know, the foundation of a building that I want to sell to you is a quicksand. Or it's some foundation that's built on something that doesn't last long. It lasts as long as your money or your food. It's not exactly the foundation you want. You want a foundation that's everlasting. So what the Rebbe was saying was very simply, he says, if you have one world and many gods, you'll be frightened all the time. You have one God, eternal, immortal, and many worlds. I have many dimensions to my life. You're going to take my physical life, I have a spiritual life. You take me, I have my children and my family. Not that God forbid he wanted to go or be killed, but you're not frightening me just because you think you have a gun in your hand. Now, of course, it takes a Rebbe to have such presence. I'm not suggesting we all can feel that way with a gun to our heads. But on a more subtle level, everybody has this challenge. What frightens you? You know, they say today everybody's for sale, which is a sad commentary. Everybody's for sale. It's just a matter of what price. Is that true? You think you're for sale? Would you like to think that someone spends enough or gives you whatever? I'm not, it doesn't always mean money. It could be something else that you actually would compromise. Now, unfortunately, we've seen torture and other situations where people compromise things that no one would ever imagine. We see today in episodes, incidents, where people go on a mountain, there's an avalanche, they're left without food, and they can turn on each other, turn to cannibalism. And you ask the people, do you think you'd be a cannibal? It's like mine, but you think, impossible. But who knows what hunger does? Who knows what pressure does? Who knows when you're under those circumstances? No one should ever be tested. In those years in Stalinist Russia and those years in under Nazi Germany, there were, unfortunately, people who became capos, and there were people who sold out their own mother and father and brothers and sisters to save their own skin, which didn't help. It's like what Churchill said, appeasement is feeding others to crocodiles in the hope that you'll be eaten last. You know, like that guy, that the two guys go camping. He wakes up in the middle of the night and he hears a bear scratching around the tent. So he says to his friend, hey, listen, there's a bear, we got to get out of here. And the friend sees this guy's tying his shoelaces, tying his sneakers. He says, what are you doing? He says, I'm going to run. He says, but you can't outrun the bear. He says, I don't have to outrun the bear, I have to outrun you. Yeah. Very life-affirming, right? Well, this is called dog eats dog. The survival of the fittest. So no one should ever be tested. But who knows what we're made of? Because we live in a fragile world, and this is exactly the world, an insecure world. And insecurity and fears drive us much more than we'll ever acknowledge. Not because something happened, because life is an insecure place. The mystics say this world is controlled by what's called the Tzimtzum Harishon. So, like they say, it's not the economy, stupid, it's not this, it's the Tzimtzum that caused all our problems. Yeah, you can blame the grand old symptom that God put in place. What's a symptom? Symptom is a fundamental concealment that created a quantum leap that turned everything inside out. Which means, imagine that life is your hand, and then you put a glove on, and suddenly the glove thinks it's in control. Inside out. When in fact is spirit and soul should control existence, the material world controls. What controls your attention? You walk down the street, who tells you what to look at and what not? Your soul or your body? Right? Because we are affected, we're sensory creatures affected by sensory stimulation, and that's what controls us. So it's very difficult to live a life and say one God and many worlds. This is the world that we know and we worship. In a world like that, all the vices, including gossip and others, are dominant, reign dominant, because that's the tools of an insecure world. Same thing like jealousy. You ever think about jealousy? What is jealousy exactly? How does it help you be jealous of somebody else? If you are completely secure in your own life and everything you have, what you need, and you're confident with it, you wouldn't need to be jealous. You wouldn't even be caring what happens with someone else. So you'll see the root of a lot of all this is insecurity. Now, most people wouldn't identify gossip with insecurity. As a matter of fact, I even saw some evolutionist psychologists explain the benefits of gossip, if it's not taken to extreme, is the importance of keeping a society honest. So people know it's like a deterrent. You know that you'll be talked about if you do something wrong. So in the olden days, billions of years ago, animals evolved. Gossip was a way of keeping people in line. Well, and that's the root of why People Magazine and Us Magazine and Star and so on are so successful. That's, I'm being said somewhat sarcastically. I would say that gossip is, if that was even the cause, it's gone a far way from there, because today it's not about keeping people in line. Most gossip is just what we call a shma. You just gossip to gossip. And it ultimately is a way of filling time that doesn't have any benefit, because you don't necessarily think your life is beneficial. If you, did someone sense to lose the sense of direction? Someone lost, huh? Yeah. I was once with somebody who says to me, I need a GPS. I said, you have one right here? He says, no, I need, for my life, I don't know where I'm going. Yeah, there's no GPS that's been created for that yet. So, I personally saw in the Rebbe, and I saw, I didn't know his father-in-law, but I assume he was the same way. There are people who every second of their lives were committed to mission. And for them, a second that was wasted was like a second that died, like a life that died. Imagine you're given 365 children to watch over. They're your children. And if one is wasted, it's like a dead, God forbid, a child that died. 365 days in the year. And every second is a life. Now, we don't have such intensity, nor are we interested in having such type of responsibility. We have a thing called leisure. I'm hanging out. What am I doing? I'm hanging out. I'm just relaxing. Nothing wrong with that. I'm not suggesting one shouldn't relax. But think of the other side of things. Someone who is on a mission every second. So every second is important. How would they have time or interest in talking about anybody else? Unless it's part of their mission. Now, this is not a question we usually ask. If we ask this once in our lifetimes, once in our day, we'd be in good shape. So that's what Bilam saw when he saw Mateva Elecha Yaakov. He saw the beauty of how a home, a tent, a dwelling place should be built. What is a dwelling place? Elecha. It's a place that gives off light. The temple, you know, was built in an interesting way. They had windows. But most windows are either just plain windows, or if you're going to build a window, you want to bring light in, so how would you build it? You'd have narrow outside and wide on the inside, so it expands. That's how they do, like skylights. The temple was built the other way around. There was narrow windows on the inside, shkufim atumim, and it went wide to the outside, which is a little weird. So if the light shined in, think of going inside the temple, and you come, you see a window with a little speck of light coming in. What do you, should have been the other way around. A little light and then spreads. So the Talmud answers with a question. The temple is the house of God. The chila eira hu tzarich. Does God then need light? His light is to give light. His role is to give, not to take. So here's another good question you could ask yourself if you want to make yourself uncomfortable. Are you fundamentally a taker or a giver? So we all know the scene in the Frisco Kid where the train robber robs everybody's jewelry and possessions, and before he jumps off, he tells everybody, remember the lesson in life. It's always better to give than to take. They're trying to console them. They should feel good that they gave him some charity. Now, the tendency is to take in this world. Why? Because we never have enough. We never know how much will be enough. You could ask this to people who have $1 in their bank account, people who have billions of dollars in the bank account. I never know will be enough. Because materialism by nature is an insecure entity. And insecurity always elicits insecurity. Insecure people will make you feel insecure. Insecure items will make you feel insecure. Someone says to you, they call it, the department's called securities, right? They call it financial securities. But if someone says to you, hey, I'll give you security by giving you something that doesn't have any permanence, how secure can you be? You know, be secure. You know why? Because I'm giving you food today. You say, one second, what happens tomorrow? I'll give you for tomorrow too, but what about the next day? So the worship of one world immediately worships insecurity and has to cause you to be insecure.
We'll be back.
Because the deepest blessings are sometimes in the most concealed places. Where do you have the most intense energy? Today in astronomy, in science, where's the most intense energy? A black hole is the most intense. It's so powerful, the gravitational pull, that no light can escape. That's a black hole. You can't even see light. So you see, look at it, it's black hole. If someone understands how the intensity, it's actually the opposite. That's where you'll find many Hasidic Rebbes or many people who really understood human beings. When someone came to them, everyone said, this person is hopeless. They're filled with so much anger, so much bitterness, so much antipathy and so on. And they were able to see, yes, they're filled, but that's energy. That means there's something that's driving this person. And when you tap into it, you know how to tap into it, you create the most enormous amount of power.